Many thanks to the organizers for the invitation to speak here. It is a privilege to share this platform with so many people from whom I have learned so much about such a fascinating subject, save money used by the central banks. The first paper I read was Michael Kunhoff, the Chicago Plan Revisited, the documents of Professor Hoover, and papers from Positive Money when they thought about changing the system some years ago. Well, we have discussed the problems of the current system in the first sessions, and excuse me. No.
Just have to click on the right.
Ah, the right. Okay. We have discussed some problems of the current system in the first session. In the second session, we'll discuss the proposals. And my idea is that both when analyzing the problems and when designing the proposals, it is not enough with macroeconomic vision, worried about the stability of the money. Of course, it's very important, but in my view, it's not enough. But it is very useful, the microeconomic view, interested in the efficiency, worried about the lack of competition in banking. Because I think that we cannot talk about the monetary and banking system without talking about banks. The singularity, the special thing of the current system are the banks, because they are the entities that create now the digital money and at the same time provide financial services, what we call the banking services, which are basically lending to families and small and medium enterprises and providing payment services. Therefore, let me see, sorry. No. May I took this because
normally it should work pretty well.
The following. May so, I took this?
Yeah.
Or
yeah. So we back at it. You just have to click on the right.
No.
It's working at the.
Ah, it's working again. Yeah. Okay. 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 Well. The problem with the current system is precisely the lack of separation between money and banking activities. The problem is that by uniting these two functions in one body, the commercial banks, what we get is that money is fragile and financial activities, what we call banking activities, are inefficient. The fragile money, the unsafe money created by the commercial banks, I use the small letters for the commercial bank digital currencies because you use CBDC, it's impossible to say, but it's easy to write. The different system that is the commercial banks create the money. Well, the fragile money that they are deposits trigger intense and prolonged recessions, and the recovery, and this is important, the way out of this crisis is terribly slow. And more problems for stability, credit bubbles, the increase in leverage, the incapacity of a monetary policy that cannot directly impact in the level of aggregate spending, many, many problems. But in addition to these problems, the current system of uniting in the banks the power to create money with the provision of financial services also produces microeconomic structural problems, as is usual in the jargon that the economists use now. Problems of lack of competition, lack of efficiency in the provision of banking services, which reduce GDP growth and the possibilities of increasing welfare. Let's see. No?
We have to click on the right one.
Is that right? Is this one?
Yeah, this one. Only this one. Otherwise, we switch files.
Okay. Okay. Yes, the problem of the current system, let's see, are that we allow banks to perform public functions such as registration and creation of money that should be provided by the state. And at the same time, we allow them to carry out, with enormous protection of the state, financial activities, fundamentally lending and payment services. They provide other non-monopoly activities in competition with others, but I'm not going to comment this out. Well, to reduce the fragility because they answer for deposits of commercial banks, the state has built two huge buildings of regulation designed to protect banks and to constrain their activities. On the left hand, the state floods the banks with privileges and protections and subsidies. And on the other hand, the state itself constrains their banking activities with a suffocating regulation. This is the banking privileges. This slide shows the endless list of protection of the state to the banks, which does not have any other private company, neither the companies of the real sector, nor the entities of the financial system, which are not banks. Only banks enjoy this mega protection from the state. Look at the list. Banks are the only ones that have the privilege of access to safe digital money from central banks. Second, the state supports depositors in private banks with deposit insurance. Three, the state provides daily liquidity support and even grants banks all the liquidity they need in times of uncertainty. Fourth, banks are the only financial entities that get money from taxpayers to avoid bankruptcy. Five, banks are the only entities to which the general bankruptcy laws are not applied, but special resolution regimes. Six, banks obtain the seniorage of the creation of the digital money. Seven, the competition laws are not applied to banks. And finally, the state has created two public institutions, supervisors and central bankers, permanently worried that the profits of the bank will not fall. Supervisors and central bankers have other tasks, but it is logical that their main concern is to maintain a sufficient level of profits from banks, because the loss of banks is the prelude to banking crisis. But with this list of protection does not end the interference of the state in the activity of the banks. Despite all that protection, or perhaps, as Kalomiris explains very well, precisely because this protection, banks take very high risk, so the frequency and severity of banking crises is intolerable. Therefore, in addition to protecting banks, the states have built another large building of regulations whose purpose is to prevent banks from taking too many risks. This other great regulatory package is the so-called prudential regulation, Basel III. As can be seen in the slide, the state orders private entities, the commercial banks, how they should manage their risk. And it dictates with a meticulous detail the directive of the European Union with all its developments occupies more than 10,000 pages, more than 2 million words. That is three Bibles. Well, but what I want to emphasize today is not the volume or the complexity of this regulation, but rather that it is a very special regulation, absolutely exceptional in a market economy. All sectors, the distribution of food, oil products, construction, the textile sector, etc., all economic activities have to comply with many regulations. But they are very different from the prudential regulation of banks. The regulation of the productive sectors deal with aspects such as security, health, transparency, and so on. But the state does not tell private companies how they must manage their business. The regulation that tells entrepreneurs how to run their business only existed in communist systems. There, they told the entrepreneurs what they had to produce or how they had to do it. And this is precisely what prudential banking regulation does, because risk management is precisely the heart of the activity of any financial company. Decide the ratio between the capital and the debt you want to have, or how you will manage your liquidity, or what risk ratio probability you think is the best at the time of investing, and so on, are all purely business decisions. And that's why it seems extravagant, unheard, and absurd that in a market economy, the state tells the banks what they have to do. But if we let the banks create money together with developing financial activities, it is essential to apply this kind of Soviet regulation. Today, it's fully justified to apply this oppressive regulation to banking for the same reasons that justifies providing them with an extraordinary protective regulation, because the money created by the bank is unsafe, is fragile. If we continue to use deposit in private banks as money, this monstrous and suffocating regulation is fully justified. Let's talk about the proposal. The CBDC proposal, in my view, fully meets the objective of separating money from banking activities. On the one hand, we would have a safe money, since the state would take care of the registration and creation of the money, as well as the payment infrastructures in case it were necessary. On the other, banking activities would be developed in competition by financial intermediaries, since by not creating money, it would not be necessary to grant them privileges, and nor should their decision be constrained by the state. And the benefits of separation are clear. We will have more stability, we will have safe money because we will use deposit in the central bank as money, and we would also have more efficiency because we would have liberalized all financial activities, including the banking activities that today are not subject to competition and market discipline. The IMF, the OECD, the European Commission, and all the central bankers, me included at my time, in addition to advising macroeconomic policies, do not cease to incite governments to approve structural reforms, that is, microeconomic policies that increase GDP growth. But in their list of reforms, they never mention the structural reform of banking. We can understand why. Although the banking reform would be the structural reform that would have the greatest impact on growth, because its effects would improve the efficiency of all sectors of the economy, it is not possible to undertake it while the money remains fragile and unsafe. But as long as the safe money of the CBDC could be used, the structural reform of the banking would be possible. And the IMF, the OECD, the European Commission, and the central bankers should include it in the list of pending structural reforms. Well, I conclude by mentioning some advantages of studying the CBDC, analyzing it as if would analyze any structural reform proposal that aims to introduce competition in a strongly protected economic sector. An advantage of using microeconomic analysis, I call micro, but probably in the terms of the classic economy, economic analysis, not is to distinguish for something that was discovered at the beginning of or the middle of the last century. It that this analysis helps to discard some of the criticisms that have been made to this proposal, such as those that say that the CBDC could increase the instability of commercial banks. Well, after reading your paper, I think there are other arguments, but I think analyzing this is important. If we study microeconomics of a CBDC system, we realize that in its final stage, there would be no commercial banks. There would be no private financial entities that could offer safe money to their clients. Commercial banks would disappear without the need to prohibit them, because without state protections, without state protection, no citizen would want to deposit their money in a commercial bank. And the banks themselves would not want to offer deposits. They would not have any interest in offering deposits, because in order to give their clients the same safety of the CBDC, They would have to deposit the money of their clients in the central bank, and then they could no longer obtain the benefit of investing that money. A different issue is that, as in all structural reforms, the transition from the current system to the CBDC system must be carefully studied. But that's different. We must design transitional formulas that help commercial banks to get used to losing the protection of the state and to work like the rest of the companies in a market economy, subject to the laws of competition and market discipline. And we must also give time to new competitors to develop new services with new technologies and without the protection of the state. Designing a transition that helps banks to transform until they disappear is a very different from saying that the CBDC has a problem because it disturbs and destabilizes the banking business. Well, the analysis of CBDC, and I ending, from the point of view of efficiency, is also very useful in my experience to convince of the advantages of having a safe money. It is normal, and I did at the beginning, to focus the presentations of the CBDC, highlighting only the advantages of stability, the security of the deposits in the central banks against the fragility and unsafeness of the deposit in commercial banks. But citizens do not see clearly that the deposits of private banks are fragile, because all the protections, deposit insurance, liquidity aids, resolution systems, has the effect of an anesthetic. In fact, these protections are designed precisely so that users do not realize the fragility of bank deposits. To paraphrase Karl Marx, just one time, we could say that deposit insurance is the opium of the current monetary system. The applause goes to Karl Marx. But if we make a detailed presentation of the privileges, protections, and subsidies, all those privileges and protection, if I were a young economist, I'm not, I calculate in terms of subsidies what all this list of protections means in value. What is the amount of money other enterprises should pay to get financial security, liquidity, no problems, no extension of bankruptcy law, extension of competition. It's an enormous amount of money that we are spending, not just in crisis, but the crises are obvious. But without no crisis, we are spending a lot of money to avoid crisis. Well, the exception, I say that if we make this, people, in my view, perceive the exceptional magnitude of everything that it is necessary to make the deposit of the private banks appear safe. People clearly understand then that if the state does with banks what it does not do with any other sector, it is because the deposit of commercial banks are not safe. Well, I return to the quote of Bill Gates attributed, I didn't check but I think it's correct. I mean, but I think we could add the following. There will be no banks in the future if we have a safe money. And we must facilitate the transformation of current banks into new entities that, without the protection of the state, provide payment services and loans to citizens in competition with the multitude of new suppliers that always, in all structural reforms, arise as soon as any highly protected sector is liberalized. Many thanks.